Hello students, welcome back. Myself Pushpendra Singh and we are going to cover your daily current affairs today. So today you have 2nd of February 2021 and we are going to cover your current affairs. This program is basically covering your day-to-day current affairs from the national newspapers. So if you are preparing for the government competitive examinations, including your civil services examination conducted by the UPSC, you can refer the current affairs program which we started from on behalf of Future IAS. All right, and we are basically covering the two national newspapers. The first is the Hindu and the second is Indian Express. Okay, so both of these newspapers are equally good. You can refer any of these newspapers for your current affairs preparation. All right, so let's begin with the lecture. So recently you are most probably aware about the budget which is presented by the Union Finance Minister in the Parliament. This year the budget 2020 to 2021 2022 basically have the logo of minimum government and maximum governance. All right, so to cut down all sort of a regulatory framework, right, or to minimize the red tapism in the governance, right, to minimize or to to speed up the clearance given to the projects, single window clearance, the minimum government and maximum governance logo is basically adopted. So here the union budget was basically presented for 2021-22 in the Parliament by the Union Finance Minister Nirmala Sitharaman, which outlines the plans for the reform in one of the six pillars of the budget. All right, so the reforms basically based on the minimum government and the maximum governance. So this budget or the forthcoming budget census would be the first digital census, okay, in the history of India. So that census would be based on digital parameters, and for that our budget basically allocated around 3768 crore in 2021-22. So you must understand that a census is conducted every after 10 years, okay. So the census was conducted in 2001, it was conducted in 2011, now this will be conducted in 2021, okay. So this year census would be based on the census would be captured, or census would capture the data based on the digital parameter. So it will be the first digital census in the history of India. For that certain amount of money have been allocated, okay. And to have the ease of doing business, okay, the government or the central public sector undertakings, right, those people or those business persons who are basically dealing with the government or central public sector undertakings, right, for carrying out certain contracts, right, for that purpose, for making any sort of a disputes very smoother so that it can be quickly resolved, a conciliation mechanism have been set up. This conciliation mechanism would give you the quick resolution for any sort of a contractual disputes, because there is always a contract between between the client and executor. So here right, so all sort of a business who basically deals with the government or CPSEs will have certain set of contracts, and to resolve that any sort of a disputes which is related to the contracts, the conciliation mechanism have been put forth, okay. And this would definitely instill the confidence in the private investors, because here certain set of private investor and the contractor will be having some sort of a contract with the government agencies, right, and there is obvious that there may be some sort of a disputes between them, and to resolve those disputes, right, a conciliation mechanism has to be or proposed to be set up, okay. And here to bring the transparency, efficiency and the governance reforms, right, in the nursing profession especially, because the good governance also having the this type of the inputs or the ingredients like transparency and the efficiency. So this year, right, to bring the reforms in the nursing profession, the National Nursing and the Midwifery Commission Bill would be proposed to be introduced in the governance, right, or in the Parliament, that will bring the more transparency and the efficiency in the nursing profession in our country. And the budget also further proposed to make to rationalize the functioning of the tribunals. Like you have the tax tribunals, right, you have many such tribunals which are basically quasi judicial bodies. They are not total judicial bodies, but they are quasi judicial bodies, okay, because these quasi judicial bodies are having some the element of the administrative personnel also. So it is not, they are, though they are conducting their affairs just like a judge, but they are having some sort of elements of the administrative also. So that is the reason it is also considered as a quasi-judicial body. So to rationalize the functioning, right, the more measures would be taken up as per the budget 2021-22. And the center will give 300 crore rupees as a grant, right, as a grant to the government of Goa, right, for celebrating the Diamond Jubilee, right, of the state celebration, which was basically liberated from the Portuguese rule. So this year, the government basically provided, or the central government provided 300 crore to celebrate, right, the gold, the Diamond Jubilee of the liberation from the Portuguese rule in the Goa. All right. So let's understand the one by one, the different parameters, okay, based on which the budget have given the significant improvement compared to last year. So first we will considering the health and the well-being. Okay, so health is most important, you know, aspect of any human habitation. Okay, so here the most important aspect here is that the total public health expenditure in our country is around 1% of the GDP, okay, which is much lesser. Okay, and many committees basically recommended to increase this public health expenditure at least to 3% of the GDP. Okay, but still it is just lagging at 1% of the GDP. So here the sharp focus was given on the health, right, especially in the budget 2021-22, right, and which has led to the steep increase in the 135% of the budget outlay for the health and the well-being. Okay, but still it is well below, you know, the target, which is 3% of the GDP, but there is steep increase in the budget outlay for the health and the well-being. And this year, the budget basically also announced the Jal Jeevan Mission, okay, which will be implemented in the urban areas, only in the urban areas. So it will have only urban component. So here, the union budget basically announced the launch of Jal Jeevan Mission, okay, which will be implemented only in the urban areas. Here, through the Jal Jeevan Mission, the central government would aimed at universal water supply. Universal water supply means for every household in the urban localities, right, a tapped connections would be provided. Okay, so here we have around 4,378 urban local bodies, right, in every urban local bodies around 2.86 crores the household tapped connections would be provided under Jal Jeevan Mission. And it will also provide the liquid waste management in 500 Amrit cities. Okay, so this universal water supply is one of the most important aspect of the Jal Jeevan Mission, especially in the urban areas. And this Jal Jeevan Mission will be implemented over the 5 years with an outlay of 2.87 lakh crore rupees or 2,87,000 lakh crore rupees. Right, so that will have outlay that will be spent over the period of 5 years. All right. Then Swachh Bharat, Swasth Bharat. So here you must understand that government of India has already started the Swachh Bharat Abhiyan. Okay, so to improve the Swachhata of urban India, okay, the budget has basically mainly emphasized on the fecal sludge management, especially in the urban areas, and the wastewater treatment in the urban areas, because this fecal sludge management and the wastewater problems are basically most rampant in the urban areas than compared to the rural areas. All right, and the urban Swachh Bharat Mission 2.0 would be implemented with a total financial allocation of around 1,41,678 crore rupees, and that will be spent over the period of 5 years from 2021 to 2026. Okay, so this shows that government has emphasized on the cleanliness as well as providing the universal water supply, right, under the budget provisions. All right, for clean air. Right, because you must understand Delhi is one of the most polluted cities, among the most polluted cities in terms of the air pollution. Okay, not only in the Delhi, but also urban, in other urban areas also in India, they are also comes under the heavily populated, right? Delhi is one of them. And to resolve such air problem, right, air pollution problems, right, the budget basically proposed an amount of around 2,217 crore for 42 urban centers, right? In those urban centers where the population is more than 1 million, right, in the budget. So for those urban centers where the population is more than 1 million, right, a budget outlay of 2,217 crore would be provided, and that would be, you know, resolving the air pollution related issues. All right. And here the scrapping policy. Scrapping means, you must understand, because the vehicles which we ply on the roads in the urban areas, sometimes they are very, very old, okay? And that basically pollute the environment, okay? So here, to phase out those old and the unfit vehicles, because ultimately you have to phase out, because those unfit vehicles or the old vehicles basically gave you, you know, lot of greenhouse gases like carbon dioxide, methane, and all sort of other, you know, the pollution, you know, related gases. So here, the most important crucial part of the union budget is to remove out or to phase out the old and the unfit vehicles, okay? So here, the budget basically proposed the vehicles should undergo a fitness test, okay, here in the automated fitness centers. So the based on the fitness test after every 20 years, especially in the personal vehicles, and after 15 years in the case of commercial vehicles, if they found fit, they will be ply, otherwise they will be discontinued or they will be phased out, right, as a unfit vehicles to ply on the roads. All right, so here under the budget 2021-22, the universal coverage of the water supply is provided, okay, under Jal Jeevan Mission, which is implemented only in the urban areas. So you have around 4,000, more than 4,000 urban localities, right, where it will be launched, and it will be aspiring for providing, right, more than 2 crores of tapped water connections in those urban localities, right, at the household level. And it will be implemented over 5 years with an outlay of 2,87,000 crore rupees that we have already discussed. All right. Then let's understand the disinvestment. Okay. So first of all, you must understand what is the disinvestment means. Disinvestment is a recurring process generally government implements, right? Through the disinvestment process, right? The government basically sold out some of the shares which are held by the public or which are held by the government. Here, the shares will be sold out, right, in the market, so that the shareholding in the government, basically shareholding of the government in a particular PSU or public sector undertakings, would be reduced down, right? But it is not something which is called selling of the PSUs, okay? It is all disinvestment means just reduction of the share of the government shareholding in the central public sector undertaking. So this process is called basically disinvestment, okay? So here the union finance minister basically in the union budget 2021-22 announced, right, a policy or approved a policy of the strategic disinvestment, okay, for the public sector undertakings, right? So that policy will provide, you know, a complete or the clear roadmap of disinvestment in the all non-strategic and the strategic sectors, okay? I will come to that, what is non-strategic and what is strategic sectors here, but you must understand that the government has proposed or approved a policy for the strategic disinvestment, through which the disinvestment would be implemented. And one of the most benefited part of the disinvestment is that government will get the revenue, okay, and disinvestment revenue. And moreover, the point is that if those, you know, public sector undertakings which are already in the loss, okay, there is no possibility of recovering those PSUs, it is better to disinvest, because it is something the new money, new, you know, technical expertise will come out, right, will bring from the private investment, and that may basically, you know, grow that particular PSU. So here the main feature of the disinvestment is that existing CPSEs, central public sector undertakings, or public sector banks or public sector insurance companies to be covered under. That means the public sector banks, undertakings, right, and insurance companies will be covered under disinvestment procedure. All right. So here the twofold classification of the sectors to be disinvested. Okay. First of all, we will take the strategic sector. And second is then we will take the non-strategic sector. Okay. Strategic means, right, they are basically most important for the security point of view, for overall development point of view, right? So it is most vital sectors. So here, the bare minimum presence of public sector undertakings or public sector enterprises were basically proposed through the budget, and remaining the PSUs will be privatized, or it will be merged or subsidiarized with the CPSEs, or it will be closed, okay? So here, the budget basically provides that there will be a bare minimum presence of PSUs in the strategic sector also. The remaining PSUs will be either privatized, will be closed, or it will be subsidiarized, right? Or they will be merged with other PSUs, right? Right. So here the four sectors comes under this strategic sector, along according to the budget. The first is basically atomic energy, space, and the defense. The second is transport and the telecommunications. The third is basically power, petroleum, coal, and other minerals. And the fourth is the banking, insurance, and the financial services. So these are basically the four sectors which comes under the strategic sectors, right? That will be disinvested, right? And here the non-strategic sectors would be privatized or otherwise shall be closed. So there is no such like merging or all such, you know, priorities in the budget. So either non-strategic sectors where the continuous loss is occurring to those PSUs, right? That CPSEs will be privatized or will be closed, right? Here. Next, basically we will take the small companies and the MSMEs. So MSMEs, micro, small, and the medium enterprises. Micro, small, and the medium enterprises. All right. So here, as we have already covered this news in our previous, the news analysis. So here, the process of the decriminalization of the Limited Liability Partnership Act was basically started. Okay. So here, the process of reformation, right, or reform the small companies and the MSMEs, right, so that this reform would enable to start up the ecosystem, right, or to boost the, you know, the startup ecosystem in our country, right. A certain set of, you know, the reform have been taken place, especially in the Limited Liability Partnership Act 2008, right, right, on the similar lines of decriminalizing of procedural and the technical compoundable offenses. All right. Right. So here, the government is decriminalizing certain procedural and the technical offenses under Companies Act 2013, which is now completed. So this decriminalization of certain offenses or compoundable offenses have now been completed. Okay. And it is further proposed under the budget that to revise the definition under Companies Act 2013. Right. So to revise the Companies Act 2013 for the smaller companies, right, that will increase the threshold of the paid up capital. So the definition which is under the Companies Act for the smaller companies, right, that will be also changed, right? So here the threshold for paid up capital, right, for the smaller companies, which was 50 lakh rupees, or that threshold for paid up capital shall not exceed 50 lakh rupees, right, that will be changed to not exceeding of 2 crore rupees, right? And as well as the turnover for, you know, for the existing smaller companies should not exceed 2 crore. That is the present condition. That will be changed to not exceeding to 20 crore. So here, the budget basically proposed to change the threshold for the paid up capital, which will be increased from 50 lakh to 2 crore. Okay. Then it is also proposed to increase the turnover from 2 crore to 20 crore or not exceeding to 20 crore. All right. And then you have 1% companies, okay? So there is also provision of 1% companies under the Companies Act. So here, the under the budget, government is proposed to incentivize, right, these 1% companies, right, to grow without any restrictions of such paid up capital or the turnover. Like previously, you have this restrictions of the turnover and the paid up capital, right? So this is the restriction where the smaller companies remain same, right? But here 1% companies does not have, right, any sort of restrictions on the paid up capital and the turnover. And and the budget also proposes that will allow them to convert into any other type of company at any time. So that will boost, you know, further the ecosystem for the startups, right, where the 1% companies will be started growing in our country, right? And as well as in the fiscal 2021-22, okay, the government will launch the data analytics, the artificial intelligence, the machine learning, which is driven based on MCA 21 version 3.0, right? So based on that artificial intelligence, based on the machine learning, right, that will provide a modules for e-security, right, the e-adjudication, e-consultation, and the compliance management, right? So here that will boost further the ecosystem for the startups in our country. All right. So these are certain reforms which is going to be taken in the, basically in the small companies and the MSMEs sector. Okay. Next, the budget also provide certain insights regarding science and technology. So let's understand about the science and technology. So science and technology, right, is most important, you know, the field in any country. So here, the overall research ecosystem of the country, right? To strengthen that research ecosystem, the budget basically announced a new initiative to boost the innovation and the R&D in our country. Okay. So Finance Minister Nirmala Sitharaman proposed an outlay of 50,000 crore that will be spent over 5 years for the National Research Foundation. Okay. And as well as 1500 crore rupees will be proposed, right? For those schemes that will provide a financial incentives or financial, you know, help to promote the digital mode of payment, right? Through that, it will boost the digital transactions, right? So here, the 50,000 crore will be earmarked over the 5 years for the National Research Foundations, and 1500 crores would be provided for the financial incentives for the digital mode of payment to boost the digital transaction in our country. Okay. And the budget also announced the National Language Translation Mission. This National Language Translation Mission is an initiative, okay, that will basically, you know, digitize, right? Or that will basically digitize, you know, or that will basically convert the wealth of the certain set of knowledge which is related to the policy related aspect or the governance related aspect. So that will digitize first of all, and that will convert, right, based on the internet, and it will be available in the major Indian languages so that it can be a readable form in the major Indian languages also. All right. And new PSU, right? You know, that is called New Space India Limited. That is a PSU under Department of Space, right? Would execute the PSLV CS-51 launch vehicle. It is a vehicle through which, you know, you have, you know, the satellites which are launched, right? So this New Space India Limited, which is a PSU under Department of Space, would execute the launch of PSLV. Okay, this launch would carry out, you know, the Amazonia satellite from the Brazil, and this launch also will carry out the few smaller Indian satellites also from the Brazil, right? So here, under the proposed budget, the 4 Indian astronauts would also be trained, right, on the generic space flight aspects, especially in the Russia for Gaganyaan mission, which is due for the launch in December 2021. Okay, so 4 Indian astronauts would be trained based on the generic space flight aspects, okay, and as well as to have the deep ocean missions, right, or to understand the realm of the deep oceans. Okay, the Finance Minister Sitharaman also launched the deep ocean mission, right, and that will have, you know, the financial outlay of 4,000 crore rupees so that we can also assess, okay, certain set of, like, you have, you know, the aluminium modules, manganese modules, right, which are found basically on the seabed, right? So for exploration of the deep sea oceans, a mission was launched with an outlay of 4,000 crore rupees that will be spent over 5 years. So here, the first unmanned mission, which is going to be launched on December 2021, for that, 4 astronauts would be trained in the, basically on the generic space flight in Russia. Okay, the National Research Foundation will get an outlay of 50,000 crore rupees for boosting the overall research ecosystem in our country. All right, and the budget also announced the deep ocean mission, which will have the outlay of 4,000 crore rupees, right, for exploring the deep oceans, right, so that it can also, you know, conserve the biodiversity which is found in the deep oceans also. Okay, then the New Space India Limited, which is a PSU under Department of Space, would launch, right, the PSLV CS-51, which will carry, you know, a satellite from the Brazil, and it will also carry the few smaller Indian satellites. All right, then we will move to our new sector, that is agriculture and the allied sector. As you all already know that agriculture and the allied sectors are the most important. Okay, it is basically accounting around 17 or around 15% of the GDP of our country, but around 50% or more than 50% of the working population is basically engaged in the agriculture. So it is the most important sector in terms of the employment, right? So here, the Union Minister of the Finance announced the 9 measures for the agriculture sector as a part of inclusive development for aspirational India, right? Especially in the budget 2021-22. So here, the Swamitva scheme, right, which was already implemented by the government of India. So budget proposed to extend this Swamitva scheme to all states and the union territories, right? So the Prime Minister Narendra Modi basically launched this scheme to bring the transparency, especially in the property ownership in the villages, right? So to enhance the transparency, right, in terms of those ownership, in terms of title deeds in the villages, the Swamitva scheme was launched. Now this scheme would be extended to all states and the union territories. All right. And under the budget, the adequate credit to the farmers would be given. So here, the finance minister basically announced the agricultural credit target to 16.5 lakh crore rupees in the financial year 22. So agricultural credit will be provided to the farmers to the tune of 16.5 lakh crore rupees in the financial year 22. All right. And the finance minister also enhanced the allocation which was given to the rural infrastructure development fund. Through that fund, the rural infrastructure basically built out, right? And another 10,000 crore rupees have been given to the rural infrastructure development fund. So it has increased from 30,000 crore rupees to 40,000 crore rupees. Okay. And you have the micro irrigation fund. Through that, the micro irrigation related infrastructure will be provided. So the Nirmala Sitharaman or the budget basically provided to double this amount which is given to the micro irrigation fund, right? So that is basically added another 5,000 crore rupees under NABARD, right? So you will have the total, you know, the corpus of around 10,000 crore rupees now, okay? And you have another scheme called Operation Green Scheme, through which you are basically proposing certain set of the deforestation measures, right? So here, also another set of, you know, like the certain set of perishable commodities, right? Like tomatoes, onions, and the potatoes. So this scheme, Operation Green Scheme, would be applicable to the tomatoes, onions, and potatoes as of now. It will be enlarged to include the 22 perishable products now. So from tomato, onions, and potatoes, now 22 perishable products will be, integrated or will be, involved in the ambit of Operation Green Scheme. Okay. And here you have, you know, the agriculture produce marketing committees. So here you have different mandis which are basically integrated with ENAM. So National Agricultural Marketing, right? So that is electronic portal. So further 10,000 more mandis will be integrated with the ENAM, right? And that will benefited to the farmers in terms of providing the transparency and the competitiveness to those farmers as well as to those mandis, right? Here, the finance minister also proposed to make available the agricultural infrastructure fund, right, to the agriculture produce marketing committees, right, to augment their infrastructure facilities. So from agriculture infrastructure fund, right, the APMCs will be eligible to get the fund to augment their infrastructure facilities. And the five major fishing harbors, right, will be developed as a hub of economic activities, because these are the fishing harbors which are also known for, you know, sustaining the fishing communities also, right? Because the fish catch generally occurs through these fishing harbors. So these fishing harbors are Kochi, Chennai, Vishakhapatnam, Paradip, and Petughat, right? So these five fishing harbors would be developed further to enhance the economic activities and to promote this seaweed cultivations, right? The finance minister basically proposed the multi-purpose seaweed park, right? This multi-purpose seaweed park would be set up in the Tamil Nadu. All right. Next, we will move to our new topic, that is petroleum and the natural gas sector. So here, the Union Finance Minister basically presented the budget for 2020-21. So here, you know, for the petroleum and the natural sector, right, natural gas sector, the existing scheme called Ujjwala schemes. Through that, you know, 50 crore BPL connections would be provided, right? So here, you know, already benefited around 8 crore household through the Ujjwala scheme. So through that, you know, the women which are residing or which are living below poverty line, right? Against that woman, the BPL connections will be given, right? Already 8 crore household have been benefited out of it. And this Ujjwala schemes, which is, providing this, you know, this gas cover or gas connections, right, to further 1 crore more beneficiaries, all right? And under city gas distribution network, right, 100 more districts will be added, right? So that will also boost, you know, in terms of the distribution of gas network in the cities. And a gas pipeline network will also be taken in the union territory of Jammu and Kashmir, right? As the Jammu and Kashmir Reorganization Act make the Jammu and Kashmir as a union territory, right? And an independent gas transport system operator would be set up, right? That transport system operator would basically facilitate and coordinate the booking of common carrier capacity, right, which is basically related to the natural gas pipelines, right, on the non-discriminatory open access basis. So that will basically regulate, you know, some sort of a, you know, the natural gas on the non-discriminatory open access basis. So here the Ujjwala connection means the women which are residing or which are there in the below poverty line, right, you know, the gas connections will be given to them. So right, so another, you know, 1 crore beneficiaries would be added. And a gas pipeline product would be taken in the union territory of Jammu and Kashmir. An independent gas transport system operator would be set up further to augment this. All right. Next, education. So understand about education. So first of all, you must understand that education is most important parameter of the development of any country. Okay. So to improve the educational aspect, the budget 2021-22 proposed the qualitative strengthening of 15,000 schools. Okay. These 15,000 schools would have all components of national education policy. So these schools will be integrated, will have components under the national education policies. So under this proposed budget, the 100 new Sainik schools will be set up, right? These Sainik schools will be set up with the partnership of NGO or partnership with private entities, private schools, or with the, you know, with the assistance of the states. Okay. And it is also proposed to set up a Higher Education Commission of India. The Higher Education Commission of India would be an umbrella body, right? And that will have certain powers regarding the standard setting of higher education. So that Higher Education Commission of India would set a standard for the higher education that will provide the accreditation to the institutions, right? Comes under the higher education. That will also regulate those institutions, as well as it will also provide a funding mechanism to those higher education institutions. Okay. And further, it is proposed to set up a central university in the Leh for accessible higher education in the Ladakh. Okay. So here, especially in the Ladakh, a central university will be set up in the Leh, right, to enhance the higher education facilities in the Ladakh region. Okay. So here, in terms of reinvigorating the human capital, the school education is more emphasized. So under new Sainik schools will be set up with partnership of NGOs, private entities, private schools, and the states. And here the more than 15,000 schools will have the component of national education policy, right? That will have the holistic development. And for the higher education, a central university will be set up in the Leh, right, to provide the better opportunities to the higher education, especially in the Ladakh region. And Higher Education Commission would be set up as a regulatory agency for regulatory body for higher education, right? Which will be have the umbrella structure for better synergy among the various research institutions, universities, and the colleges which are involved in the higher education in our country. All right. Next, we will move to the securities market. Okay. For the securities market, you must understand the budget 2021-22 would basically provide that consolidation of certain provisions of certain acts would be done. So it will be rationalized into a unified or a single security market code, right? So existing provisions of those security market codes which are there under different acts, that will be rationalized, right? That will be brought into the single security market code, right? So under the provisions of the SEBI Act 1992, the Depository Act 1996, the Security Contracts Regulation Act 1956, and the Government Securities Act 2007, right? So these four acts will be rationalized into the single security market code, all right? And the government will support the development of world-class fintech hub that will be set up in the GIFT IFSC, which is located in the Gandhinagar, Gujarat, okay? So world-class fintech hub would be set up under the GIFT IFSC. Okay. And the most important point is you should also build the confidence among the participants in the corporate bond market. So here you know, especially to provide, you know, to enhance the secondary market liquidity, right? The union budget basically proposed to create a permanent institutional framework for this, okay? And to provide the protection to the, you know, to the investors, the finance minister also introduced, you know, a charter, right, which will have a right of financial investors across all financial products. So these charter will basically safeguard the you know the basically you know their own you know rights under the financial products. All right, and to establish a system of regulated gold exchange in our country, right? The Security and Exchange Board of India, SEBI, will be notified as a regulator for this, and warehousing development and the regulatory authority, which will be strengthened to set up a commodity market ecosystem arrangement for the gold exchange in our country. In our country, all right. So this is what we have discussed just now. Okay. Next, let's understand about financial sector. Financial sector. So here, the union budget basically provides, you know, certain reforms in the financial sector also. So here, the most important reforms is the government will amend the Insurance Act 1938. Okay. So under Insurance Act, currently the permissible FDI is only 49%. So it is proposed to amend this Insurance Act 1938 to increase the FDI limit to 74%. Okay. So that it allow the foreign ownership and the control with certain safeguards in the insurance sector. So it is proposed to limit, increase the limit, right, of the FDI from 49% to 74%. All right. So here, under the proposed new structure, the majority of the directors on the board, right, and the key management persons would be resident Indians, right, so that it can be safeguarded, right, and that will have at least 50% directors would be independent directors, and a specified percentage of the profit being retained by the retained as a general reserve with those, you know, with those partnership. All right. And an asset reconstruction company limited would be set up, okay, as well as the asset management company will be set up, and that will consolidate, right, the existing stress, you know, debt. For example, you have a lot of debt with the corporate sector, right? To recover that debt, the asset reconstruction company and asset management company would be helping to recover the existing stress debt, right? As well as these asset management company and asset reconstruction company would manage such the stress debt, as well as it will depose, right, or dispose of the existing assets to the alternative investment funds to certain corporate sectors. All right. And in order to consolidate the financial capacity of the public sector banks, the government basically proposed the recapitalization of 20,000 crore, right? So here, the public sector banks will be recapitalized of 20,000 crore rupees this year for 2021-22. All right. And the, you know, in order to help the depositors also of the banks, right, which are currently under the stress, so certain banks are currently under the stress, okay, government will move, you know, an amendment to DISGC Act 1961, right, in the current parliament session to remove such stress, right, for non-banking financial companies, NBFCs, the minimum asset size is currently 100 crore rupees. The minimum loan size eligible for the debt recovery under the Security and Reconstruction Financial Assets and the Enforcement of Security Interest SARFAESI Acts is proposed to be reduced, right, from 50 lakhs to 20 lakhs only. So here, you know, the debt recovery under the SARFAESI Act, which will be reduced from 50 lakhs rupees to 20 lakhs rupees under the SARFAESI Acts. All right. So thank you very much for attending this session. We will meet again tomorrow for our new current affairs. Thank you very much.